welcome to the start of a new series on the book that Paul wrote to the church at Philippi. A man is on death row, awaiting to hear the result of his appeal, and he writes what is probably one of the most encouraging pieces of writing ever recorded. The year is AD 61. Jesus has been dead for nearly 30 years. The good news about his death and resurrection has extended from Jerusalem to Samaria and Antioch in the north, across Turkey or Asia Minor, as it was called then, into Greece, and is beginning to reach Rome, the capital of the empire. Christians are being arrested for their faith in Christ and therefore have to meet secretly in the catacombs or underground caves beneath the streets of Rome. The Christian communities has heard that the man they call the Apostle Paul, a converted Pharisee, has come to Rome by ship from Judea, under arrest for preaching the gospel. Now, you can read about his arrest and travel by ship to Rome at the end of the book of Acts, particularly chapter 28. Some are terrified that an outbreak of persecution will soon occur, but others have taken confidence that one of their leaders has been prepared to fearlessly proclaim the gospel and face the consequences. Paul has been under house arrest, which means that although he is chained to Roman guard, he is allowed to receive visitors. So Christians are visiting him and are being encouraged. Every time a Roman soldier comes on shift, he too hears the gospel as well. So now, from that prison cell, Paul writes a letter to one of the churches he planted 10 years previously on his second missionary journey at the top end of Greece. The place is called Philippi. It's named after the father of Alexander the Great, Philip of Macedonia, and is situated on the Ignatian Way, the main arterial road linking Europe with Asia and Rome, with its eastern colonies. Now, Philippi was a prosperous Roman colony which had many retired Roman soldiers living there, and only a few Jews, and not enough to justify a synagogue in the town. Paul and Silas had visited the city on foot in AD 50, and the book of Acts in chapter 16 records three incidents from that visit. The first is the conversion of a businesswoman named Lydia, and the casting out of a spirit from a slave girl who told the future and earned a lot of money for her owners. This resulted in the subsequent arrest and beating of Paul and Silas. They were then imprisoned, and while they were praising God in the jail, a violent earthquake occurred in the prison, and although the prison doors were opened, the jailer, seeing what had happened, was about to take his life. When Paul now assured him, all the prisoners were accounted for. So as a result of that incident, of this miracle, the Philippian jailer and his family were converted and baptized that very night. And thus began the church at Philippi. Now, Paul's reason for writing is that the church had been supporting him in his ministry, particularly while he was in prison in Rome, and had sent him a gift carried by a man called Epaphroditus. Paul sent this letter to the Philippians back with Epaphroditus to thank them and to encourage them. And the one thing that you'll notice coming through this gem of a book is Paul's joy in the midst of extremely trying circumstances. Not also the incredible encouragement Paul is to the church, which is now beginning to suffer the early stages of persecution. And in this first section, despite his own circumstances, Paul, like his master Jesus, devotes much of his letter encouraging the believers at Philippi, who are beginning to suffer arrest and persecution. So let me read from chapter 1, verse 1. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you in all my prayers for all of you. I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Now, in verse 3 and 4 and 5, he's praying for them and thanking God for their support and partnership in the ministry. In verse 6, he says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It's right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. And whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for you with all the affection of Christ Jesus. So in these verses 6 to 8, he reminds them that God will complete the work he started in them. How can he say that? Well, because their generosity and sacrifice and giving into his ministry to spread the gospel is a clear sign that they have come to a saving faith and that the work has been truly begun in their hearts. And if it has begun, God promises he will bring it to completion. When we are generous in giving, it's because we serve a generous, giving God who did not spare anything to win us to him. Paul is also desperate to tell the church in Philippi that his imprisonment is okay and all part of God's greater plan. He says, whether I'm in chains and defending or confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. When he was under arrest in Caesarea on the east of the empire, he appealed to Caesar, knowing he would be taken to Rome and tried. And he looked forward to going to the capital so he could use it as an opportunity to share the gospel. Now he is on trial for his life, and he could have got discouraged and depressed and given up, but he uses this apparently negative situation for the advance of the gospel. Let's read now from verse 9. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and in depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Now, in these verses, Paul prays for them to grow in love, to grow in wisdom and discernment so they can understand and fulfill God's perfect will for them. So friends, as we look at this first section, 1 to 11, what do we learn? Well, the lesson I believe is that we can be a blessing to others even when we're going through tough times. We've got to see God's hand in your situation and use it to glorify him by your positive response to your seemingly negative situation, and then by continuing to encourage others and to pray for them. That would be the mark of the true believer. Come, let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for the incredible example of Paul, who was able to love and encourage and talk about joy in the midst of his suffering. We pray we would learn something from that and emulate it in our own lives, particularly when we're going through tough times. We ask your blessing as we do this in your precious name. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you for the second of our series tomorrow. Thank you.